Thank you. Well, I'm going to start with a story of a friend. I'll keep using different names because just to make sure, because I don't use the same name so that I don't use her name. But a friend of mine, she's a single lady, and I will call her Mandalay for now.
Hey.
Yes, and she's single, and she has 4 children. She is unemployed. She lives in Kailisha. And she used to have a job. She was working before, but she was a security guard. So she worked odd shifts in order to get home safely because of the odd shifts that she was doing. She had to change her safety with her body. Basically, she had to sleep with the men who had to make sure she gets home safely. So she continued for a while, and she realized she couldn't do this anymore. She couldn't keep this up. So she had to stop and not go to work anymore. But she has a family that she needs to look after, but she can't anymore. None of her children qualify for a grant. So she became homeless because she couldn't afford even to pay for the rent of the shack that she was living in to be a security in the city. So when I think about Kailisha and when I think about the city itself, I don't like to think about it in terms of just the structure, just the system, just the place where we are. I like to think about it in terms of stories, in terms of people. And these are people that I am close to. These are people that I interact with. These are people that I live with. Having to try and fight and figuring out how now do you engage somebody like my friend Mandalay in changing the city? How does she become involved in that? Now, when we think about Kailisha, I think Lutando has really spoken a little bit about townships, and he really went into detail, a lot of detail about it. But the name Kailisha itself means new home. It's a promise of something beautiful. So when you go into a new home, you have expectations. You're thinking that there's a new future, a new beginning. There's a whole lot of promises. But as you can see in my picture, the township or the Kailisha where we are located, where we are situated, it's somewhere so close and yet so far. As you can see, you're locked in. You're in a place where you cannot necessarily access the city. You cannot access the wealth of the city. You cannot access the life that seems to be promised. So Kailisha itself, born out of violence. Mandalay's sister often likes to tell me the story of when they moved to Kailisha from Crossroads. She remembers vividly, and she paints the picture for me of those dogs that were barking, of the buses that were standing there, of the loudspeakers that were hauling people into the buses, packing up everything that they owned, and having these police vehicles and sirens going on, moving them and saying, promising them a new home somewhere where they were going to find home. She recalls to me about how she cleared the fields and how they came to live there, and how they put their shacks. In one day, a new home was built. We live in a state of vertigo. So that butler, that door that you see there, that has locked us in, has created inside of there what the city was hoping to get, only cheap labor, what was not really good, what was inhumane, created for us a constant state of trauma and pain. We're in a vertigo, in a drum that keeps rolling and never stops. And as a result, there's a lot of self-hatred that happens in this space. There's a lot of vulnerability that happens in this space. There's disembodied hearts and souls. So it's not, when you think about a city, it's not just about the structures, it's not only about the buildings, it's not only about the businesses, it's not only about the location, but it's actually about the people, it's about the souls. I like to challenge the systems that we talk about when we're thinking about development, because development itself, you often use a blueprint approach. It has worked somewhere else and we think it's going to work here.
Yeah.
And it often wants to beautify the space rather than actually resolve what is the problem in the space. It focuses on material gain as development. Only if we can build these infrastructures, things will be okay. Only if we can build this, if we can put this in place, things will be okay. It also uses a lot of predetermined assumptions. Maybe they're lazy. Maybe it's too far. Maybe if we just put a bus, it will connect them to the city, we can still get our cheap labor.
Yeah.
It is a paternalistic in approach because it assumes that you have the answer, you know what's best, and you know what to do. So the approach that I like to maybe even put across is that of building community. And by community, not only talking about location, but rather looking at how do you build communal spaces where people can actually live in community with each other. A thing that focuses, or maybe a process that focuses a lot on human flourishing as opposed to money making. Building a sense of community and actually promoting a quality of life. So what the city wants to do and how the places where we live, they're created. Not only the slide here, the picture that I have here, you may see that there's a baby, there's a child on a naked wound of a the vulnerability, the kind of vulnerability that we live in. Now, this is a state of a lot of people. This is not only children. This is all of us. So if you look at this picture, there's a lot of craziness going on there. You cannot think about transforming the city without thinking about the people who live in it, and especially those who are most affected by it. How do you then engage people whose hearts have been disembodied, whose souls have been misplaced, whose bodies are just another commodity for other people and for the city itself? They're no longer human, if you would think about it. That's the place where I'm located. That's the kind of work I have to, that's the kind of work, that's my life. If we want to transform the city, I suggest or maybe like to talk about what I call creative resistance strategies. Creative resistance strategies are a form of protest that engages differently than confrontational protest. This is a system or maybe an action that focuses a lot on ourselves. Those of us who find ourselves in that vertigo kind of state, in the place where we are broken. How do we then engage with the city? How do we engage in transforming the city ourselves? So when we do creative resistance strategies, we act the future. We live what could be. We try to bring a different alternative story that we are engaging in. So in other words, moving ourselves from a place of death to a place of life. Taking ourselves basically and not just being receiving what the city is lashing out to us, not allowing ourselves to basically be formed and to be molded into a particular shape, because literally what the city intends to do, we are just a commodity that supplies the city. So we are just a machinery. So you can think about the city as being a machinery. So we are cheap labor, we are there to do some things and help the city go forward. And yet, what we receive at the end is nothing to be human about. How do we bring humanity back to ourselves? So we do this by basically living out a preferred future. We want to invite the world to see a different alternative of life. So what we engage in, so the creative resistance strategies, they're also very communal in nature, because to be human is to be together.
We do not promote or maybe enhance the individualistic kind of life that promotes the mechanical sort of life. So the creative resistance strategies, they're counterformative. In other words, they're forming us into something different than what the machine wants us to be. They also engage us. When you live in a constant state of trauma and pain, sometimes you don't feel it anymore. Because it's normal. And sometimes it is so overwhelming that you find yourself mentally and emotionally paralyzed, unable to do anything. So when we engage in the creative resistance strategies, then we are able to bring back a sense of feeling, even if it's feeling the pain itself. But we have to feel again, because we have to be human again. And so by engaging in this, we are able to critique the city itself, we are able to critique the system itself, but also we are also able to energize ourselves to say, yes, we can, and we can stand against what the system is trying to create of us. So I am part of Ujamaa. Ujamaa, that word itself is a Swahili word that means collective. So we are a collective, and we stand on three values: self-reliance, solidarity, and service. Self-reliance in the sense that we want to build communities that are self-reliant, not dependent on the system, because by depending on the system, we are allowing ourselves to be formed into what the city wants us to be. And we stand in solidarity with each other. So which means we live with each other, we cry with each other, we laugh with each other, we eat with each other. And yes, that is a picture of Ujamaa right there. The space in which we find ourselves in. And we also live in service with each other. So we want to serve. So we do things for others, for each other, without expecting anything in return. Because we understand that to be human is to be together. And if we are not able to serve one another, there is no way that we can build a sense of community amongst ourselves. So how we work, we use communal and home gardens as a place of protest, as a place of engaging with the system, but also as a way of a creative resistance that we engage with. In the communal and home gardens, we use open space, we use the word guerrilla gardening, because we take any land, any open space, and we plant food. We believe that by making food available, we address firstly the basic need that we have, because part of the reason that the city is able to have such a hold on us is because we're hungry. If we can feed ourselves, we will be able to stand and say no to the city. We also use arts and cultural expressions as a means of lament, as a means of celebration, and as a means, I'm gonna get upset. I was trying not to be upset, but I'm getting upset, so I'm just warning you. I'm getting upset.
It's all right.
So, because we have to lament. So we do lament as part of the arts and cultural expressions. We also engage with, we use different ways. So part of the platform and the arts and culture expressions is that we engage ourselves in being able to reflect on the city, reflect. So we're not only just saying we're gonna do this, but actually we have to, our actions will reflect on them. And so we theorize and we have philosophies and we have, so we're just not doing things outside of theory. So we, since we're in a university, I gotta use that. So we kind of develop our own theories in the space as well, but also give each other tools to be able to engage with that. And so we use collective approach. And so we have what we call rhythms of work and rest. In this, we mean that work should not be slavery as it is right now to us, but it should be a meaningful part of life. But also to understand that rest is a luxury for a lot of us that we can't afford. So in the space that we, and where we are, we try to create that we can work, but also we need to rest and make that space. So that space is basically created to enable all of us to be human again in this space, to be human to each other and human and our own environment. So I'm going to stop right there because my time is up.